I'm Ray.
And I'm Chiara. And today, we'll be talking about vitamin D3. So, vitamin D is also known as the sunshine vitamin. And we hence understand the importance of exposing our skin to sunlight.
Yeah, and it's actually the UVB rays that's in contact with a cholesterol called what?
7-dehydrocholesterol.
Yeah, 7-dehydrocholesterol.
In the skin.
In the skin, and that's producing cholecalciferol.
Right, so then this cholecalciferol travels through the bloodstream to the liver and is transformed into?
Calcidiol.
And then from the liver it goes to the kidneys and it becomes?
Calcitriol.
And calcitriol is just the fancy name for vitamin D3, which is really the most active form of vitamin D3. So exposure to sunlight, and we're talking about exposure in the hottest parts of the day. So we really want the sun to be quite high in the sky. This means that the UVB rays are penetrating the atmosphere of the Earth. If the sun is any lower, if it's quite low to the horizon, you only have the UVA rays coming through. And this is also important to know, because exposing your skin to sunlight through glass is actually damaging to the skin, and you are not getting any of the UVB rays onto your skin. Learn to expose yourself to the sun wisely.
Yeah, so minimize your exposure. Be balanced in your approach, right? Don't go to extremes. Don't lie in the sun for hours at a time. You're going to prematurely damage your skin. Right?
Yeah. And a way of preparing your skin for a healthy production of vitamin D is by exposing it gradually at the beginning of the season. So really preparing the pigmentation of the skin to receive the sun rays in a healthy and beneficial way.
Mm-hmm. Well, here's a fun fact.
Tell us.
You only need about a half an hour on average of full body exposure, that means completely naked, fun fact, to produce 10,000 international units of vitamin D, which is well over your daily required intake of vitamin D. Now, what about me though? I mean, I'm dark pigmented.
You are, aren't you? Well, that means you can expose yourself more to the sunshine. Okay, and so this is an important thing to keep in mind. If your skin has a darker pigmentation, you will need to be more exposed to the sun for longer periods of time to produce the adequate amount of D3.
Darn.
Which also brings us to weather.
Weather. Yeah, well, we live in the northwest of Vancouver, Canada, and most of the year there isn't enough sun exposure to get adequate vitamin D with our limited time outside.
Yeah, 100% of Canadians are actually vitamin D3 deficient throughout the winter months. So I guess this probably leads us to the next part of our presentation. What alternative sources are there for vitamin D?
Well, I can tell you about D3.
Right.
D3 being the most active form of vitamin D. Right? When we come exposed with the sunshine, we are storing D3 in our bones, in our liver, in our brain, our spleen, right, and our skin. If you do consume animal flesh, you can get vitamin D and D3 in ample amounts from liver, right, from bone broths, right, and also from fat, from dairy, you know, particularly raw dairy that's actually been exposed to the sunlight will have produced active D3.
Yeah.
And you can get it from egg yolks.
Yes. Raw butter would be a great source of vitamin D3. So if you do have a farm close by or access to organic milk by happy cows, then that could be a very good source of vitamin D as well as other nutrients.
What
cod
about
liver oil, oily fish. Can't forget those. They're like the
nutrient powerhouses.
But, yeah, of vitamin D.
But they also bioaccumulate toxins. So
yes,
what are some plant or alternative options for vitamin D?
Well, let's talk about yeasts and funguses.
Yes.
Tell us about them.
Well, in the case of brewer's yeast, or other, well, any yeast, actually. Any yeast, any fungus, mushroom, mold, right? Being that they're alive, they're actually producing vitamin D2 from ergosterol.
Well, basically, vitamin D is essential for bone health because it will drive calcium, phosphorus, magnesium, anything that we need for the mineralization of bones into the bones.
And teeth.
Teeth, so important in child development to really get the skeletal system nice and strong.
But I really do want to mention though with the fungus part.
Please finish that
part. because wild mushrooms, right? I personally don't like brewer's yeast.
Uh-huh.
And I don't really like yeast in general.
Yeah.
And the yeast
they're not
actually
good for everyone, are they?
No. Roughly 30-40% of people can't digest them effectively. Mm,
yeah.
Right? So getting wild mushrooms is better because even with the yeast, it needs to be exposed to sunlight
right.
for it to actually occur, for that
to D2 activate
that,
it.
Yep. So eat mushrooms that are wild, that are naturally getting exposure to sunlight, and you'll get your yeast.
Right.
Yeah.
So we saw vitamin D regulates calcium metabolism in the body. It also plays an important part in your heart health, in the nervous system, in the immune system as
well.
Yeah,
absolutely. In conjunction with vitamin A, it plays a key role in immune health.
And we see that cultures who do live with greater exposure to sun will suffer a lot less from osteoporosis and all bone-related things, also osteomalacia. Menopausal women, okay, who will often manifest symptoms of deficiency, such as osteoporosis, as well as other things like depression, hot flashes. They could really benefit from not only calcium supplements, because calcium supplements on their own are just, they're just a lonely guy who doesn't know what to do. So.
Well, you see, that's the thing. You need vitamin D to actually absorb calcium from the stomach, right? As well as an adequate pH, and then drives it straight to the bones.
Drive it home. Right.
So, I'm Ray.
I'm Kiara.
And if you like this video, just hit that like button on YouTube.
Or Facebook.
Yep. Share us on Facebook.
And
subscribe to our page.
Yes, and a lot more to come.
Yeah. We'll show you bone health and how exercise and increase your absorption of calcium.
Bye.